Okay, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to, I guess this is our sort of last and final round before we hit the big time. We're down here at the Silver Buckle. We're interviewing Tom and Kurt down here at the Silver Buckle, and I have to steal a line, or actually it was a title of their first album, It's About Time, because I tell you, we've been chasing these guys for the last few months trying to get an interview, and I'm very happy to say that we finally were able to nail them down here at the Silver Buckle Inn. And on that note, then we're going to open and say welcome to Tom and No, Kurt and Tom. 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 Kurt. Whatever. One way or another. How are you doing? Welcome to Hat Cable 10 for us.
No, I'm glad to be here.
Not the first time the Medicine Hat by any stretch of the imagination. I know.
No, I've been here a few times, that's for sure.
Picking and a grin.
Yeah, we know a lot of people here.
Yeah? Well, you're originally what? From Lethbridge, right?
Lethbridge, that's right.
How long have you been doing this business?
Kurt and I have been together 9 years. Tommy's been with us 4 years.
Really? Yeah. And that's and you're working on a second album now too?
Working on selling it.
Working on it.
We got it done.
two albums. The first one that I remember was It's About Time, and then the second one is...
We named that after one of our girlfriends. Yeah, sure thing. We won't mention any names.
Don't mention no names at all. You stay pretty much local, Alberta?
So pretty far, well, yeah.
Yeah, pretty much. You're involved musically... What would you classify the music you're doing? Everything and anything?
We do pretty well. I don't know what.
No hard rock.
You know everything.
Middle of the road. Yeah.
Sort of middle of the road.
We're not really super country, but we're not really rock and roll.
Well, I love the stuff you're doing. Whatever it is, it's sounding great. That's for sure.
Thank you. Well, you can walk
Millsap tune there from 1981.
Work together as a duo first off, or how did you start in the business?
Well, Kurt, before Kurt played bass, I had a band, and the manager of Cable 10 here, Grant Pisco, was our bass player.
Oh, for goodness sake.
Then he decided he was going to go on to this bigger and better things. Couldn't handle this weekend stuff. And then Kurt came along. Uh-huh. We had a band, and then we'd play on weekends with the band, Friday and Saturday. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, we'd play as a duo, and we started making so much money as a duo. Goodbye, band.
We had to quit our jobs and go to work as a band. As a two-piece, you know?
What did you do before the music business? Speak about a job before.
Oh, yeah. Well, I worked in a packing house.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, packing beef and stuff like that. It was really boring. I hated it. It was really hard to take the two jobs, so I had to make up my mind what I was going to do.
Uh-huh. And you decided to give it your all, eh?
Do this, yeah.
Well, good. I know we're happy we are.
Oh, you got that right.
And what was Tom up to?
I worked for the government.
Oh, yeah. Civil servant. Yay,
civil servant, and the city of Lethbridge.
Oh, my goodness.
And then I quit. And then Kurt and I played for about 7 years before we realized that we needed this fella right here. Picked this wild Irishman up from, he moved to town from Fort Francis.
Oh, yeah.
Ontario.
So how long have you been in, you've got an awful lot of beautiful set of
13 years, I think. Yeah? I'm 13, I forgot, so that I just don't count.
you went into a band first, I guess?
I was playing when I was 16, 16 years old. Mm-hmm. I had trouble on the road for 4 years.
Oh, yeah.
Called Chaparrals in Ontario. Mm-hmm. And I moved out here in 70, in May of 70. Uh-huh. And I played with some local hot stuff in Lethbridge.
Still thought
know just what it means. When I die, you can bury me. Love of Texas in my chest. Today, day I started loving you again. What fool I was to think that I'd get by with only these few million tears I cried. But I should have known that the worst was yet to come. And the kind time for me has just begun. Today I started loving you again. Now I'm right back where I've really always been.
Indifference.
There's a little song we just recorded a little while back. A song about a girl named Sheila from way down there in Mexico.
Yeah.
A year would you say you guys play out like
some years it's better than others.
I'd say we play about 45. Yeah, take 7 weeks off, and then some of those we just play weekend gigs.
Mm-hmm. Keeps you away from home quite a bit though.
Well,
we're lucky we play at home.
We've got a couple of house gigs at the York in Lethbridge.
Oh yes.
And at the park. They're about maybe 35 weeks of the year.
Yeah, that's Park Plaza, by the way, not the Park Lane.
Oh, okay. That sort of keeps you at home then, eh?
But this hotel here, for Medicine, this is the only place we play, and it's great. Uh-huh. We used to play at the Continental.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
But this place is it's like home.
Oh, yeah, really. That's great. That's nice to know. It is a beautiful place. They've packed this place out just about.
It's a cozy place. Uh-huh. Really cozy.
Especially on the dance floor. You get caught on the dance floor, then everybody wants to come on the stage with us. That's kind of nice.
Yeah, that would be fun.
It's great.
They've got a whole new gig here. They've got strippers in. I think they're allowing them into hotels in Alberta now.
Is that right?
Yeah. Well, New York just started doing it.
Yeah.
Do you think that would affect like live musicians? Remember what happened with disco?
Yeah, I think we'll probably
disco
not
and
notice
the lights and
stuff. Well, I know one thing. We're going to be on time for work.
They always have the show.
We'll be there for the last show.
So let's do a dance for the dealer. She knows what's more for the good times we're back with.
You.
And I should see you, babe. I watched it way out of my mind. To a house, and she opened the door. She stood laughing, and I felt the knife in my hand. She laughed no more.
Song called Cookie and Lila.
He was a short article, and not too much to look at. I traded in his coat for a medal. She sees a crooked smile as she opens up the screen. And he says, "Hi, love, have a cup of coffee. But take a load off, take your shoes off. Here's the sugar and the cream." Serves the rigors whiskey and resists their invitations to
Can I believe in you?
About jeans that fit like Orson Welles' designer jeans any which way but loose. She tried to hide it by the faded denim clothes she wore, but I knew she'd never been a sight for before. And I felt like a peasant who just had been a queen, and she knew I saw right through those tight little jeans. To wear a curl, and I've always dreamed of being just a good old boy's girl. And tonight I left those crystal can lights to be in the dream. And partner, there's a tiger in these tiger dreams. Best to make her dreams come true. She played out her fantasy before my eyes had seen that cowgirl came alive inside those tiny jeans. And in my mind, she's still a lady, and that's all I'm gonna say. And I knew that I'd be broken by the time we part ways. And I know I held a woman most I've ever seen. I'd get that lady wearing tiny jeans.
Plans from here? Where does Tom and Kurt go from here?
Well, the Park Plaza on Monday.
No, but do you set like most in any kind of a business? I'm sure you must look at it as a business type venture. Hey, you have to set up a sort of a list of priorities and where you want to be, say in the next year, maybe the next 5-10 years or something. Yeah. Can you see yourself doing? What do you see yourself doing 5-10 years from now?
Well, probably.
We'll probably still be just doing the same thing.
Pick an undergrad.
Yeah, I mean, you got to just wait for the breaks.
Or packing meat, one of the two.
Or packing more meat. Yeah. Well, it depends on the economy, you know, like it's getting tougher and tougher for everybody. A lot of people are talking about job security and everything like that. I think we probably got the most secure jobs, but even after a while, you know, when there's no more money left, when that can be a little tough.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
you find a lot more clubs now are opening doors to live entertainment.
Clubs are doing it.
Yeah,
that's what's going to make a difference for I think the live bands eventually. Mm-hmm. Clubs and nightclubs, bars, but yeah, I think this economy is going to make it a lot better for the private clubs, simply because of the fact that they can charge less money for drinks and stuff like that. So people show up there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's something interesting. I just was in the news the other day. The Oilmen's Club in Calgary are finally letting in doctors. Apparently, they're lowering themselves somewhat, I guess, which I thought was kind of funny. As a matter of fact, the columnist or whoever was talking about it said, "My goodness, we let in doctors first. Next thing you know, grocery checker, clerks, and whatever else you've got." It was amazing.
The guy that used to own this place or run it, Bill Steiner, he's opened a new place in Calgary called Bronco Billy.
Oh yes,
we'll be there in July, maybe for Stan PB,
that'll be nice.
Along with Rick Morgenstern.
Oh yeah, and hold on, you're here for all of this week.
Mm-hmm. Right. That's right.
And then from here back home for a while.
Right. Yeah. Uh-huh. We'll be back again. I don't know.
couple months.
Is it good for a musician or a group or a band or whatever to restrict themselves to one hotel, like such as you fellas are doing?
I think in a place like this it'd be better because
you don't want to sort of
create hard feelings. Like we've had offers to play at the Park Lane, but for right now it's better to
sort of just stay with one mainstream.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we were going to, as a matter of fact, show an album. Maybe you can tell us a little bit about something that's always fascinated me, the recording aspect of an album, money-wise. It takes a pretty penny to produce these things. And
well,
yeah. We're a good friend. That's true.
There we are.
We've got probably less than, I would say maybe about 10,000 in two albums.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I would imagine about 10,000 would do one album in a bigger studio. Mm-hmm. You get a fairly... maybe 10,000 to record it without the album.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But we just recorded to our fans.
What's new in your albums more than anything else? It's not a big market for us. Uh-huh. It's just people that we meet when we're on the road and when we're in town.
What process do you utilize to say select certain records? Just things you're getting requests for?
Down and figure out which one we can do the fastest on tape without costing us too much time.
Let's get this thing together. Yeah,
we want to do. There's a few songs really seriously that we like to do. Mm-hmm. So we work with those and see how they work out. That's pretty well how we did it. We just got together and...
A lot of them we get a lot of requests for.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, the ones you get the requests for are going to be the ones you do the best anyway.
Exactly.
Hopefully.
Well, the first album you did, It's About Time. I think maybe we can get a close-up of the album. And that's Tom and Kurt About Time. And you say the other Tom was with you.
Yeah,
he was...
I was playing studio drums at that time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's of course, this album, It's About Time. I think we got a pretty good shot of this one. And the next album is... That's Sure Thing.
That's right. The sure
and
thing.
That's the one that's named after a girlfriend somewhere.
You'll notice it's got a pretty sure hand on there too.
Royal Flushing
Hearts. That's pretty close to being a sure thing.
That's great stuff. Who does your photography, Lord?
This one, Brian Wilson, did this one, and unfortunately, somehow we managed to not get his name on the album for the picture, and we're really sorry about that. But he did a really good job for us on that.
That's Brian Wilson in Lethbridge.
That's right, Wilson Studios.
On 13th Street North.
13th Street
did
North.
You hear that, Brian? Thank you.
And where do you record these things?
We recorded. Basement.
This basement
one,
tapes.
The first one was done in Lethbridge at Southern Sound Studios, and the second one was done up in Red Deer at
Garber Lacey Garage Studios. Yeah. But he's since moved to Lethbridge. He's got a new studio, 16 tracks.
Oh. Yeah, Liberty Studios.
Mm-hmm. Liberty Sound.
Liberty Sound. Yeah.
Some fun. Turn me loose.
liberty. Let sailors turn me loose and set me free. Let sailors turn me loose and set me free.
Also mention, I think I got to give this a plug here. We're having a benefit jam session this weekend, and it's going well Saturday, May the 8th, and it's going to happen at the Westlander. What we're trying to do is raise some funds for the YMYWCA.
Right.
And well, at first off, we wanted to sort of get some money together for them for their women's fitness center, and we tried to work that in conjunction with Mother's Day, which is of course this Sunday, and we've since then had the place burned down, and I guess they need a few extra dollars, and I want to extend an invitation to you fellas, and if you can make it, we'll be more than happy to have you along, and I want to say at that point then thank you very much for, well, the interview, and also letting us be a part of the show here.
Thanks for coming down. Appreciate you taking the time coming down here.
And we'll catch your show again next time. Tom and Kurt, right? Okay.
Right.
They're from Lethbridge and are doing a fantastic job. They're here at the Silver Buckle. We're going to be here all week long, and by all means, drop down and see them. And this is another edition of The Good Times. Thank you very much for letting us be a part of your evening, and until next time, happy trails to you. Eat your heart out, Greg Rogers.